with Valerie Pringle and Ralph Ben-Murgy.
Merry Christmas. This is Midday for December 25th.
Today on the show, we're going to give you some presents. We hope you're having a wonderful time at home and that you got the presents you wanted, but we have a couple of extra presents for you. Some of our favorite interviews in the past year.
One of the big presents I got this year was finally, after many years, I had a chance to talk to Lily Tomlin when she was in Toronto. She's an unbelievable comedian, and she was talking about her new movie called The Search for Signs of Intelligent Life in the Universe.
And Hume Cronin will be here as well. He's got a new book called A Terrible Liar, all about his life on the Broadway stage and on screen in Hollywood.
We'll have some music for you as well because it's Christmas, Lorena McKennitt and the Razorbacks. But first, here's the Midday News.
Hello, I'm Lisa Pappas with the latest CBC News. The world awaits the resignation of Mikhail Gorbachev. He is expected to announce his resignation as president of the Soviet Union later today. The announcement comes after Gorbachev handed over the reins of power to Russian President Boris Yeltsin. Bob Abernathy of NBC News reports.
At the Kremlin, Gorbachev's staff has packed up and moved out. His mail from all over the world has been collected. And as he has so often before, Gorbachev goes on television tonight, this time to announce and probably to sign his resignation. The old Supreme Soviet, the former Union's top legislature, is expected to vote itself out of existence, perhaps tomorrow, as the new Commonwealth of 11 independent republics succeeds the old Union. More than anyone else, Boris Yeltsin, president of the Russian Republic, will take over Gorbachev's power, including the codes and signals to order use of nuclear weapons. In retirement, Gorbachev will keep 20 bodyguards, two cars, a country dacha and a Moscow apartment, and 4,000 rubles a month, a generous salary in Russia, but the equivalent of about 40 U.S. dollars. Gorbachev says he'll support the new Commonwealth, even though he doubts it's strong enough to work. He'll stay connected to public life as president of a research foundation that bears his name. Bob Abernathy, NBC News, Moscow.
Boris Yeltsin is poised to take control of Soviet nuclear weapons today. There are four republics with nuclear arsenals in the new Commonwealth of Independent States. And Yeltsin says he alone will be in charge of their 30,000 nuclear weapons. The Russian president says he'll take over the nuclear button just minutes after Mikhail Gorbachev's resignation. In an interview with CNN, Yeltsin sought to reassure the world that the new Commonwealth of Independent States will work towards peace.
The Commonwealth is going to abide unwaveringly by the commitments taken by the Soviet Union in terms of non-proliferating the nuclear weapons and ensuring international security. Russia, the Ukraine, Kazakhstan, and Belarus guarantee reliable control over the nuclear potential of the former USSR. The nuclear button today will be passed over to the President of Russia, and we will do all we can to prevent this nuclear button from being used ever.
Earlier, Boris Yeltsin outlined plans to withdraw troops from the disputed Azerbaijani territory of Nagorno-Karabakh and from Georgia. And he said Georgia cannot join the new Confederation of Independent States because of human rights abuses in the former Soviet Republic. Opposition forces have been battling government troops in the capital of Tbilisi. At least 30 people have died in the fighting so far. Supporters of the president are now reportedly gathering about 10 miles west of the capital to join the fighting in the next day or so. It was a silent night in Bethlehem this Christmas, except for the sounds of caroling. Hundreds of pilgrims gathered in the traditional birthplace of Jesus. It was the most festive Christmas celebration in the Holy Land in several years. Stan Bernard of NBC News reports.
Bethlehem is the center of the Christian world on Christmas Day, but Jesus' birthplace was chilly, overcast, and rainy, and that was blamed for reducing the number of pilgrims today. The fear of rocks and tear gas raining down, the clashes of the Intifada kept pilgrims away in the previous 4 years, and last year the Gulf crisis kept tourists out of the entire region. This Christmas season is easily the best for tourism in the 4 years of the Palestinian struggle against the Israeli occupation.
We'd like to wish the world a 1992 be a year we get peace, especially right here.
But this morning, most Bethlehem shops were closed, possibly because of the strike called by radical groups who have rejected the Mideast peace talks. But it is attending midnight mass on Christmas Eve that brings pilgrims from around the world together with Arab Christians in Bethlehem's Church of St. Catherine. The Roman Catholic Patriarch, Michel Sabah, in the multilingual mass called for peace between Palestinians and Israelis, saying neither of us has the right to attack the other in the name of God. However, the euphoria that swept this region after the Madrid talks has dissipated, especially among the moderate Arabs. Stan Bernard, NBC News, the Holy Land.
And that's the latest from CBC News. I'm Lisa Pappas. From all of us here at CBC, happy holidays.
Welcome back. Like Ralph's house, eh?
Pretty nice here.
For Christmas Day, we thought we should come to a special place for Christmas.
This is a special place, actually. It's in Hyde Park in Toronto. It's called Colburn Lodge, and it's 1837 they built this place.
Yeah,
it's a historical museum. It's really neat.
John Howard built this. He was the first engineer and surveyor of Toronto.
He did a fine job.
It's nice.
Still standing.
Very cozy here. And today we have a special place for you on this Christmas Day, and we've got some of our all-time greatest hits. We'll be talking to Hume Cronin, Lorena McKenna will sing, and the Razorbacks, but first, Lily Tomlin.
Now, most of you know about Lily Tomlin from her days on Laugh-In when she was doing Ernestine and everyone else, and she certainly made a big hit out of herself then, but she managed to sustain her career and stay on top, really, doing a mixture of Broadway and movies. Well, she's put them both together in a new show called Searching for Signs of Intelligent Life in the Universe, and Valerie got to speak with her at the Festival of Festivals last fall.
Lily Tomlin is with me. Show me the T-shirt.
Evolve or die.
Let me start with the beginning before you've evolved. Okay. And starting out, how you must have really wanted it badly. I think anybody starting out in improv clubs and doing comedy, like 30 years ago with all these guys.
I don't know. When I see performers and I think, you don't know what really impels them along, drives them to do this especially if they have any originality, because people are basically rejecting them at first, so you don't know what and empowers them to keep going, you know, and I think it's arrogance, frankly. You have to...
You don't seem arrogant.
No, but I think you have to have a little artistic arrogance in your little heart, you know, when you're 18 or 19 or 20 or something like that, and you're trying to find a niche for yourself and a way to go and hold on to whatever style is intuitively evolving, you know. Because people will constantly try to derail you or put you in a more conventional direction or something.
People must have been doing that to you for almost 30 years.
Well, not quite.
Like 25?
I mean, but a long time, sure. I don't know what, you know, you're right. You're absolutely right about people wanting it. They must want it. There's something that absolutely is obsessive and on fire, you know, that would allow you to keep doing it and face the rejection. I think about one time I went up to... I went up to read for Chuck Grodin. I didn't know him then personally, but he was directing Lovers and Other Strangers, you know. And it was one of my first. I never got a part from an audition anyway, because I was such a bad auditioner. And I went up and I was going to do the part, audition for the part where the girl, her fiance comes over the night before the wedding to tell her he's calling it off. And he talks for like a 10-minute monologue about, you know, it just isn't the right thing. I don't love you anymore. Just a whole litany of stuff about why he's got cold feet and he's not going to do it. And, of course, she listens for 10 minutes, and she says, did you pick up your tux? And so who knows what I was doing for 10 minutes? I must have been going through every gyration in the world, you know, trying to get this part and listen for 10 minutes. Because Chuck came up to me. I told him later that he did this. He said, oh, I couldn't have done that. And he came up, and he said, really, he put his chair up close to me, you know, and very quiet and paternal. He said, have you ever acted before? And, you know, I was so devastated. I didn't know what to do, and of course, I went outside, and I ran in the phone booth and broke down into sobs. So, you know, but you have to, the next morning, you forget that. You put that out of your mind.
When people saw, like, Edith Ann or Ernestine.
Oh, they didn't like Edith. No, you're right.
And Ernestine. Because didn't you once accept, like, go to the Emmy Awards in character?
First of all, I presented myself with these Russian wolfhounds, you know, like that to the crowd. And Joan Collins was there. And what happened was when Ernestine stepped out of the limo this day, and I had these two guys in livery, and all the fans were across the street, you know, and Joan was just going up the steps, and I really loved her for this, you could see. But when Ernestine stepped out, and then the guy in livery presents her with the leash, and she presented herself in this dress with these dogs and everything, like an old star, of course, all the kids in the gallery back there just started screaming. And Joan turned around because she thought it was probably for her, you know, and she saw Ernestine there and she just cracked up. You know, she wasn't the least bit put out or anything. She was just great. Anyway, so, and then the best part was, of course, Ernestine didn't win, but I stayed in character for like 5 hours. And here's how people relate to something like that. You know, some people are just, you know, they don't understand it or they think you're a little bit crackpot. But other people, the ones, that, you know, like Sharon Gless was great. She'd come and she'd say, Ernestine, you look so lovely tonight. And so here, first, it is questionable why a grown woman would sit, you know, 5 hours with her face. You know.
So, did you answer like Ernestine, too?
I was sitting there for 5 hours like this. Thank you. Thank you, Miss Gless. I'm a big fan of Cagney and Lacey. That kind of thing.
And I've always been, you know, interested in the fact that you never laugh at your characters. You're never making fun of them. You've always had this tremendous amount of empathy for them, even if they're crazy.
Well, well, I prefer it that way, but, I mean, you're really laughing at the species, you know. I mean, you can laugh at the species, but there's no need to laugh at any one individual because we are one, so, you know.
Okay, we'll be back with Lily Tomlin after this.
We will. We'll be back.
Promise.
Stay tuned.
I need extra tartar sauce for that side of clams.
Hey, and make it snappy, Howard. Everything looks so nice. Excuse me while I fluff up. My space chums are due any minute. Look at this side. Fresh as can be. We got a top-level meeting with Richard Leakey, Tim Leary. Settle some questions that we got about evolution. Seems like you ask me if evolution was worth its salt. It should have evolved something better than survival of the fittest. Yeah, I think a better idea would be survival of the wittiest. At least that way creatures that didn't survive could have died laughing.
I know our town pretty well. It's a good size. Getting to know people is easy. We all depend on each other. I mean, people count on the fact that when they need something, when they're in a bind, someone they trust will come through for them. That's just the way life works around here.
Big V Drugstores. We're a part of your life.
For a limited time only, it's double Club Z points blitz at Zellers.
Get it now. Get it on the double.
Now, get double Club Z points and get handy Rubbermaid Serve and Savers food containers at half price. That's right, half price.
Get it on the double.
Imagine double Z points that can get you a fantastic free Club Z gift today.
Double Z points.
I know, I'm an adult. I should eat a nutritious cereal. But there's this part of me that wants great taste! Grow up! What about fiber? Fiber, schmiber, go for taste. Taste? I've got to think about fat, salt, wimp.
Wait, there's mini wheats from Kellogg's. For the adult in you, whole wheat fiber, low in fat, no added salt. And for the kid in you, mini wheats has a delicious light frosting.
So make the mature choice. Go for taste!
Yes! Get it together with mini wheats from Kellogg's.
Glade plug-ins keeps on freshening with 30-day refills.
Plug it in, plug it in.
Gently warms to freshen for 30 days. After 30 days, pop in a refill. Plug into freshness with Glade plug-ins.
Plug it in.
Now a better way for a cleaner, fresher toilet. Toilet Duck. It swoops in and attacks the grungies under the rim where ordinary cleaners can't always reach. Leaving the bathroom smelling Toilet Duck fresh. Goodbye, grungies.
I'm back with Lily Tomlin.
Hi. How are you? Good that you came back, too.
Do you feel you've changed? You know, this is evolve or die. Do you think you've gotten sort of mellower, gentler, wiser?
Well, what it is you just become more accepting of the world. I mean, we used to have a line in the play, you know, once you've tried to change the world, you find it's easier to change your mind. But,
We tried to change the system, and the system changed us.
Yeah, exactly. I think
it was in the context of you better be aware that you could still, you have to.
Excuse me, go.
Here is a news bulletin from the CBC National News Service. Mikhail Gorbachev has resigned as president of the Soviet Union. He did so in a nationally televised address just moments ago. It was a short speech, about 10 minutes long, much shorter than Mr. Gorbachev's usual addresses. He ended the Cold War, the Warsaw Pact is dissolved, but Mr. Gorbachev leaves an unpopular figure after 7 years as president of a country that no longer exists. Let us, without further ado, play you some of Mr. Gorbachev's resignation address.
Dear fellow citizens, dear fellow countrymen, because of the existing situation with the formation of the Commonwealth of Independent States, I am ceasing my activity in the post of President of the USSR. I am taking this decision for reasons of principle. I was firmly in favor of independence, the independence of peoples, of the sovereignty of republics, but at the same time, for the preservation of the Union state and the integrity of the country.
Well, once again, Mikhail Sergeyevich Gorbachev resigning as Soviet president after 7 years in the job. The country, the Soviet Union, that he once ruled no longer exists. It has been transformed into the Commonwealth of Independent States. Stay tuned to CBC News all day long. We will have updates as they become available on this new day in Soviet and now Russian political history. I'm Steve Paikin in Toronto.
Everybody's so busy and so driven and so high-powered
Are you?
Well, I'm busy. Yeah. I mean, I'm a workaholic, I'm sure of that. You don't really have a lot of time for everybody, you know? You see people at events. It's unfortunate. That's what draws you together, you know, or else working. I mean, I stay in touch with Betsy. I stay in touch with her indirectly or directly. We run into each other or because I adore her little girl, Sophie. And luckily, that's one way you keep track of people, too, is through their children. You know, you get pictures on their birthdays or at Christmas and things like mm-hmm. that, and you see them growing up on your refrigerator door.
The first movie you were ever in was Nashville, and it's interesting given the success of that you've never really done a dramatic role since.
Well, people don't see, you know, it's very hard to break people's image of you. It took me a long time even to get in. I wouldn't have gotten a movie even at that time if it hadn't been for Altman, because people thought I was Ernestine or someone like that from Laugh-In. You know, they never would think to put me in that kind of role. And Altman probably never even saw Laugh-In. And he cast me as Linnea in Nashville.
Which must have been wonderful.
It was, yeah. I was very excited because, in fact, the thing about it is that I thought, gee, when I read the script, I thought, well, I could play any one of these parts, you know, and I wonder why he cast me as Linnea. And then as everybody started coming to Nashville and they were all so perfect, I thought, gee, I must be really perfect for Linnea.
Do you feel like this film, The Search for Signs of Intelligent Life in the Universe, has finally got you, that this is it?
It's probably better than any other movie I've made. Maybe
a showcase.
My performance probably gives me more opportunity, naturally. You know, I'm sure it showcases me better than you know, most everything else I have done, because it's a much bigger mm-hmm. vehicle and many more colors and things. But I did have this kind of dream about translating that moment, the end of that whole catharsis at the end of the movie, and when Trudy turns to the audience and says the audience is art, and in the theater there would be such a collective rush about it, you know.
Goosebump experience.
Yeah, that I said I wish we could translate this to film somehow. If we could make that happen in a movie theater, it would be great. I mean, it was my desire to do that, you know. Whether we succeeded, I can't say, but you want to have that. You just wish that could happen again and again.
I'm getting divorced. I'm raising twin boys. I have a lot of job pressure. I've got to find one. The ERA didn't pass. Not long ago, I lost a very dear friend. And the woman, my husband, is in love with is quite a bit younger than I am. And you think it's my period and not my life.
So what do you do now that you've found the meaning of life and searched for signs of intelligent life in the universe?
Well, I haven't found it. You know, Trudy says that she doesn't know the answer either. She says if all of this is meaningless, then why the hell bring up the subject?
Why do you work so hard?
Why do I work so hard? Well, because I love it, because I like to make something. I've been making shows since I was a kid. You know, I made shows in the backyard or on the back porch or in the garage, and I just always loved it. You know, it thrilled me. You don't even think about it. That's what you do. You just do it organically, intuitively, viscerally. You make a show. And I always had this passion to have a stage and have a curtain. And if new kids would move into the apartment building, like these two brothers moved in one year, you know, and they both had red curly hair and freckles. And I said, Arthur Godfrey and Howdy Doody were brought to me, you know, so I could put them in my shows.
Really?
Yeah. Anyway, Tommy and Billy Barnes were the brothers.
And they're proud of you.
I wonder. I don't know. I imagine they're a little bit proud, sort of.
And your parents?
I could tell you the greatest story about my father. I got famous on Laugh-In shortly before he died. My mother and father were living in Fort Wayne, Indiana then. And so I went to visit them. And my father took us out to this, like a neighborhood tavern. You know, you call it a tavern because it's a little more respectable than a bar. You know, and you can take your family there because they serve food like chicken in the basket, ribs in the basket, shrimp in the basket. And so my father's sitting there eating, you know, and the waitress comes over, and my father's real excited about me because of being on Laugh-In and everything. So he points to me, and he says to the waitress, says, who do you think that is? And she says, well, I guess that's your daughter. And he says, yeah, you're damn right. And there was a young couple playing the piano and singing, you know. And he said, babe, get up and sing a song for the people. And I said, oh, Daddy, I couldn't do that. I can't do that. I'd be too embarrassed. He said, babe, get up and sing a song for the people. I said, Papa, please don't make me do this. I can't do it. He said, babe, you got to learn how to be popular.
I won't ask you to sing, but it's been lovely to spend the time with you. Thank you so much for your time.
You're very welcome. Thanks for your time and everything.
She's fine.
Yeah, isn't she wonderful? I think she's wonderful.
All right, when we come back, we're going to...
I think you're wonderful.
Well, geez, shucks, please. When we come back, we'll have more for you. The Razorbacks will be here, and Tom New will give you one-liners in the movies. As well, we're going to hear the Celtic classics of Lorena McKennitt.
Stay with us.
The odds of having quintuplets are about 1 in 57 million. The odds of winning an instant lottery are 1 in 4. More than you'd expect, right? Play instant lotteries. Odds are you'll win more often. See your lottery retailer for the latest games.
For the top brands in hockey equipment at low prices... Nobody addresses Canada's needs so completely as the more than 400 addresses of Canadian Tire. Giving you the time to turn that raw talent into tomorrow's pro.
You know, son, the goalies are the real stars of this game.
Okay, bring in the city. Good. Now, add some perspective, please. And bring in the mountains. Nice, nice. But let's try the mountains at sunset. Okay, we should balance the picture. Move the mountains to the right. No. Go left again. That's it. Cue music. And stand by. Cue announcer.
Television advertising. We can move mountains for less than you think.
Kathy Cushion for Valenti Real Estate. We would like to wish you and your family a very happy holiday season. Now, the Valenti Showcase is taking a short holiday vacation, but will resume on January 5th. And we invite you to tune in during the new year. In the meantime, all the best to your family from the Valenti family.
Happy holidays from Valenti!
It could take years to create a masterpiece. But in 1 month, over 2.5 million people in Ontario win with instant lotteries. Shouldn't you get your hands on it instant? Play instant lotteries. Odds are you'll win more often. See your lottery retailer for the latest games.
That is the beautiful voice of Lorena McKennitt of Stratford, who It seems to harken from a different time, and the journal's Lori Brown went to visit her, and she has this report.
An independent success, she manages herself, composes her own material, and has produced and distributed three albums on her own record label. But Lorena now has a major record deal and a new album that explores the earliest days of Celtic music. It's called The Visit.
In some of these earlier, more primitive cultures, they felt that this earthly existence is a visit, and that through the course of reincarnation, that, you know, there would be another visit and could be another visit until we get it right. And so this theme weaves itself in and out again through the recording. The creative impulse is a kind of visitation. I can guide it through my scale. I can practice to make sure my technique is good. I can bring upon it some other factors. But in essence, you have to leave yourself open for the idea, for the inspiration. And that's really what I call the visit.
But it's her visits to Ireland that really feed Lorena's creative instincts. She makes a yearly visit there to the home of the music she loves. The song The Old Ways explores the inevitable passing of time and traditional Irish ways.
As we pass to gaze on the tumbling sea, the vision came on of thundering hooves and aging wheels and clouds above turning to gold. Heard you call out my name like a bird in a cage, spreading its wings to fly. The old ways are lost, you sang as you flew.
But home for Lorena is a long way from Ireland. She was born and raised in a farming community just outside Winnipeg and began her career as an actor. That brought her to Stratford 10 years ago, where she both acted and composed music for the Stratford Festival. Now, many musicians wouldn't attempt to put Shakespeare's words to music, but with Lorena's background, composing for a passage of his romantic tragedy Cymbeline is simply a good use of her dramatic talents.
It's my feeling anyway that this is Shakespeare's take on life and death, that all things come to pass, and that it's, you know, it's not such a big deal in a way that even chimney sweepers come to dust, or all lovers come to dust, and that we must embrace that concept to really live our lives fully. Are moving very fast and at a very intense kind of rate. So I'm very curious to look back into other periods of time where the scale and the intensity of things are moving at a different kind of rate. The ingredients work together in different kinds of ways, and see if some of those ingredients have any relevance to our contemporary time.
For Midday, I'm Lori Brown.
We'll be right back.
For a limited time only, it's double Club Z points blitz at Zellers.
Get it now. Get it on the double.
Now, get double Club Z points and get handy Rubbermaid Serve and Savers food containers at half price. That's right, half price.
Get it on the double.
Imagine double Z points that can get you a fantastic Greek Club Z gift today.
Hi, I'm Ted Laternus.
And I'm Tony Whitney. Each week on Driver's Seat, we bring you all the latest in the world of cars. We review vehicles from all around the world and tell you just what we think of them.
We also have interesting features that are sure to inform and sometimes amaze you.
Plus, all that's happening in automotive news.
And tips that'll help you become a better driver.
So if you want an honest, informed view of today's car market, join us on Driver's Seat, Saturdays on CBC.
What do you think is new about the 92 Ford Tempo and Mercury Topaz?
I should know this.
Very close.
All that on top of AM/FM stereo, and your choice of no-cost automatic or no-cost air conditioning. The 1992 Ford Tempo and Mercury Topaz. Now even more value for the money. They're the result of positive thinking.
Yeah, I can imagine that.
Shriners help kids. Kids like Rich Belanger.
5 years ago, I lost my feet in an accident. Thanks to Shriners Hospitals for Crippled Children, I've been able to remain as active as my friends. More active than some. And the care that I received at Shriners Hospitals didn't cost me and my family one penny. If you know someone under the age of 18 with a problem of the bones, joints, or muscles, the Shriners might be able to help.
Shriners Hospitals. 1-800-361-7256.
I haven't always taken care of you the way I should have. But I always loved you.
I know that, Joe. I've always known that.
That is Hume Cronin and his wife Jessica Tandy from that heartrending scene from the movie Cocoon 2. Hume Cronin grew up in London, Ontario, in a very privileged family before heading south to make his name on Broadway and later in movies. He's written his memoirs about his early days called A Terrible Liar. And the book looks back at the distinguished 60-year career.
What worries me is the compass. Knocked to pieces. That's a bit awkward.
One of his breakthrough roles was in this Alfred Hitchcock movie in 1944. Their collaboration continued off-screen as well, with Cronin working on several scripts for Hitchcock. But many of his best performances have been on the stage, often opposite his equally famous wife, Jessica Tandy.
People may buy my books by the thousands. They may write me letters telling me that I break their hearts and make them bawl their damned heads off. But I know the truth, all right. It's you that makes me sing.
His stage acting earned him a Tony Award, but he's always said his greatest accomplishment has been his long and happy marriage. And more recent movies like Cocoon 1 and 2 have showcased that relationship.
Well, it's a miracle. It's a complete remission.
I just love to see you eat your words, Doc. You want to arm wrestle?
And joining me now is Hume Cronin. Hi. You know, in reading, I always knew you were Canadian, but I had no idea how Canadian you really are. I mean, you have some very serious and respectable roots here.
Oh, I thought you were going to say it because I said, you know, what's going on outside the house?
Out and about in the roof.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, you're John Labatt, grandfather, your father in the House of Commons, a relative who's a Premier of Ontario. This was not in any way hard for you to walk away from, that whole sort of I come from.
It was hard for me to escape from.
Yeah?
Not walk away from.
Why?
Well, when you grow up and you've got all those formidable relatives, when you go to a school and your brothers have been there before you and your uncles, and when you see that, you know, when I went to Ridley, the name of the first head boy ever was W.H. Cronin, my uncle, and when you're told about the accomplishments of your elders and betters, it can become very daunting.
What was expected of you as a Cronin?
I have no idea. You know, it was my great-grandfather was the first Bishop of Huron. There was the clergy, there was the law, and I suppose what was expected of me was that I be reasonably respectable.
So you just had to be an actor.
And, well, my family were very supportive. It wasn't the old cliché story of coming from a near Victorian family, or at least Edwardian, and having to battle my parents. I didn't have to battle my parents at all. They were very supportive. I think they were bewildered, but they were helpful.
In reading about you and your father, the relationship, I didn't know if I should be sad or not, because there seemed to be reverence, certainly, but also a certain amount of distance in the relationship.
Absolutely. I mean, I only spent, that I remember, I went away to boarding school when I was 7 years old. That meant that I only came home on holidays, Christmas, Easter, things like that. And very often he was busy, sometimes he was away. I did spend one wonderful 10-day period with him, sharing a tiny, I can even remember the colors, green silk tent up in the Nepagon when I was 8 years old. I think it's in the book. And we were fishing. And other memories I have of him were triste. I mean, it was he wasn't well, and the illness lasted for about 8 years. And he was, in some respects, sort of haunted man. I mean, I've never forgotten my saying to him at one point, saying, "What are you thinking about?" He just said, "The long, long thoughts," which is very Irish.
They say, though, that we become like our parents, whether we want to or not. Do you find yourself thinking the long, long thoughts?
Yeah. I've inherited that. I hope I've inherited some of the other things, too. He was a marvelous man.
You know, when you spoke in your book about going to make your way as an actor in the United States, that the line between Canada and America isn't quite as thick as we here in Canada would like to believe, that it's a bit thinner than that. And I wondered if the average Canadian reading that would go, "Well, no, wait a minute. I mean, if there's one thing that defines us is that we're not Americans." You don't find that much of a difference, or you didn't find it yet?
No, when I was young and before I'd ever been in the United States, I used to hear my family speak about, oh, well, of course, he's an American. She's American. And it always carried some sort of connotation of distinct difference, largely of values. The Americans were money grubbers. The Americans were very often nouveau riche and vulgar. They were. I remember the first time I was taken to England by my family, and I was going through Winchester Cathedral. I think it was Winchester. It was one of the big cathedrals, and I got bored silly. And I had a hat, and I kept tossing the hat. And finally, I did this with the hat. The hat didn't come down. And it was perched at a rakish angle on a stone knight, you know, on top of a tomb. And to the intense embarrassment of my family, they had to send for a verger, and he got a stick, rather like a pool stick, but a cue. And he lifted it down, and then he gave us a little lecture on the vulgarity of Americans and their lack of good manners. And I had to pipe up and say, "I'm sorry, I'm not an American. I'm a Canadian." You know, it was, but the...
And he was to say, "Well, act like one," or anything?
Well, that happened to me a lot. But this difference is certainly there and to be respected. But... hell, like it or not, we are cousins. I mean, it's, and I think certainly culturally, it's a pity that the differences are so distinct and so much is made of them. I mean, I've run into this numbers of times, and because I am ambivalent about it, I mean, I've lived my life. When I left Canada, there wasn't one single professional company in the country. There was no such thing as a drama school. If I wanted to follow the profession, I had to go either to the UK or the USA. And I probably opted for the USA, not because I had closer links there. There were far more links with people in England and Scotland and Ireland, but because it was closer to home. But I find it hard to get exercised about the corruptive influence. And some of it is corruptive. I mean, some of it. Crap. To which we, but the Americans suffer from it as much as Canadians might on television.
Mm-hmm. Do you think of yourself as having become an American?
I've always been a very distinct Canadian.
Hmm.
But I can't tell you how much I owe to the USA.
We'll be back with more of Hume Cronin right after this.
Hey, Mike, you're alone?
No, my parents are over there.
Hey, look, my parents are sitting with your parents.
I guess they're making friends.
Yeah, I guess they like it here.
Why would they spill my coffee again?
It's okay, she's allowed to make a mess here.
You deserve a break today.
And it's good to get them out once in a while.
That's McDonald's today.
We are the children of the world. We hold the future in our hands.
We are the children of the world. And this is what we understand. There is enough food in this world to feed us all.
There is an answer if we just return the call. Give your heart, give your soul. All together we can show we care. We care.
You can help make sure the hope of a better and brighter future stays in the hearts of these children. The Christian Children's Fund of Canada provides clothing, food, medical care, and education to children in 40 countries around the world.
All together we can show we care. We care.
Their hope is you. Please, call now.
Over 1 million Canadians have diabetes, but half don't know it. Blurred vision can be a warning sign of diabetes. Don't ignore it. Please see your doctor, because so much can be done.
You red-headed snippet.
Anne is back, all grown up, and leaving Green Gables.
Please say yes.
I can't.
Anne of Green Gables, the sequel. Part 1, Sunday on CBC.
What's wrong?
Not a thing.
Oh?
How do you stay in love with somebody for all those years?
That's easy. I don't know how.
It never was an effort?
To love Jesse?
Mm-hmm.
No.
You think you're lucky that way, or?
Oh, I know I am. And it grows stronger. You mustn't confuse loving somebody with a constant state of adoration. There are moments of quarrels, there are moments of close to hatred, there are moments of loathing, there are moments when you want to escape, there's pain. Of course, I mean, I don't know why so much is made of our marriage, but a lot has been.
Because I think it's close. You work together.
We work. And that's difficult. I mean, you share the same bed, the same breakfast table, the same rehearsal process, where you often have different and conflicting opinions. The same stage, the same supper table, the same everything. Over and over and over, not just for days, but weeks, months, sometimes years.
Mm-hmm.
And you can say, give me room. Let me breathe. I just have to escape. I want to close the door. You know, and Jess is wonderful about that.
I guess I'd like to kind of end where we started, in a way, talking about fathers and sons. When you speak in your book, I wonder if your children don't perhaps look at you with a certain amount of reverence and even some distance.
Well, I don't think there's much reverence involved. Parenting is tough work. And The unhappy part of it is you don't get your report card until years later. I saw much more of my children when they were growing up than my parents saw of me. And I thought that was a plus. I hoped it was. Jesse is implied at times, without being unkind or overly critical, that I missed a lot of the fun of the kids growing up. And that implies that I was very self-preoccupied. I was at that point far busier professionally than she was. I just don't know whether it's true or not. It's come out rather well in that I feel we are very close to our children. I mean, they are very good friends.
You don't mind if we still call your own national treasure, do you? Can we still steal you for that?
I'd be flattered. You don't have to steal me. I got to say it again. I'm a Canadian.
Thanks.
I don't say that for effect. After all, I've had how many years? 1932? 32 from 90, that's
48.
I've had, no, 58.
58?
I've had 58 years in which to change my mind. It hasn't happened yet.
I don't think it will then. Thank you for talking to us.
Thank you. You've made it very easy.
This is nice. All right, now there's something that's almost as old as this house, and that's the constitutional crisis that this country seems to be going through, and has been going through in one way or another for quite a long time. Well, there's somebody out in Saskatchewan, Mark Barron from CBC in Saskatchewan, who's got the whole constitutional thing pretty well wrapped up. Mark?
There's a whole lot of toxic political squat about what keeps this country together. Everywhere you look, TV, radio, or books, the story's getting longer, not better. It's the Constitution you see Meech Lake 1, 2, 3, watch the National, even Midday spout their glory. And there's a paper trail from the Globe and Mail pumping out yet another story. I had it with the noise, Boris Sanders' boys. Clark Mulrooney, what an institution. But the freeze frame highlights, all that media hype, man, it's ruining my Constitution. The radio game is as much to blame when it comes to blowing hot air. Wow! Zosky and Co., as it happens, you know, they eat up this constitutional fare. Explain distinct, they'll ask their guest, their chef, Monsieur MVT. C'est plus compliqué que tu penses, mon vieux. Notwithstanding, of course, he'll say. My brain goes numb. I feel kind of dumb. Why didn't I think of that explanation? Yo, this media hype has got me wound so tight, it's ruining my constitution. Give me the life, the country life, free from the constitutional cares. The peace and quiet of a prairie day, the sun, the wind in my hair. This land I love, mon beau pays, will last a lot longer than me. 134 years we've had it good, je dis à ma grande famille. We won't get tanked or sell to the Yanks, no, we won't join their fancy union. So enough with the noise, hands off, boys, you're ruining my constitution.
Tom New has been the movie reviewer for Midday since it started almost 7 years ago. We thought this Christmas we would be really nice to him and give him the gift of being able to do anything he wanted. So he's prepared something special for us. This is what he wants to do. So go ahead, Tom. Make my day.
Famous movie lines. Innocent enough on the printed page, but when they're repeated time and time again, some of them become cultural touchstones. With that in mind, we present a Christmas list of the most famous movie lines of all time.
Toto, I have a feeling we're not in Kansas anymore.
Of course, putting together this kind of list is subjective, which makes it all the more fun. Now, the movies themselves don't even have to be all that good, but for some reason, delivery perhaps, or a magical turn of phrase, a line of dialogue will become as well known as the movie itself. Case in point, Casablanca. The granddaddy of all quotable movies has got to be Casablanca.
He's looking at you, kid.
Of all the gin joints in all the towns in all the world, she walks into mine.
I think this is the beginning of a beautiful friendship.
Most of us know by now that the line for which Casablanca is most famous was never delivered. Play it again, Sam. Well, not quite.
If she can stand it, I can. Play it.
For some reason, though, the Phantom line took on a life of its own, even becoming a title for a Woody Allen movie.
To be or not to be, that is the question.
Now, we're not including Shakespeare in our list. The guy's already had enough publicity, thank you. We're talking movie dialogue. You know, the lines everyone quotes.
I could have been a contender. I could have been somebody.
While we're on boxing, how about this polysyllabic effort?
Your agent.
Now, Rambo could have said the following. Monty Python beat him to it.
Just a flesh wound.
War and conflict give rise to a lot of memorable lines. Sure, the horror is catchy, but so's this one.
I love the smell of napalm in the morning.
Love is always good for a quote, as was the truly insipid love story.
Love means never having to say you're sorry.
No, but it can make you nauseous. Now, in some cases, famous movie lines aren't really lines at all. Now, we're starting to get into Dialogue Hall of Fame here, the lines which everyone knows.
My name is Bond, James Bond.
I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore!
He slimed me.
Oh, no.
And, of course, one of the toughest lines in movie history, and it's all in the eyes.
You talking to me?
Finally, and here's where the arguments begin, the top five movie lines in descending order. Number five from every movie he's ever made, Arnold.
I'll be back.
Number four, Marlon Brando again, as tough as De Niro.
I'm going to make him an offer he can't refuse.
Number three, the movie wasn't all that hot, but the phrase lives on, especially in the media, from Poltergeist 2.
They're back.
The second most popular movie line is a classic from a classic. Men swooned and women were outraged.
Frankly, my dear, I don't give a damn.
And the most famous movie line in history, used in the playground and on the world political stage, take it away, Clint.
Go ahead. Make my day.
Don't do it. For Midday, I'm Tom New.
We love the Razorbacks. And I don't know if you watch Midday. It seems throughout the year we get them to drop by and play a piece of music for us. Well, today is a perfect day, and they have a song just for us. It's about the big man himself and all his little followers, like you. It's called